Melinda presents this unabridged recording of Velocity, written by Steve Worland and read by Sean Mangan. Steely-eyed missile man, phrase. Place of origin, Houston, Texas, circa early 1960s. Type, NASA slang. Definition, an astronaut or aerospace engineer who quickly devises an ingenious solution to a life or death problem while under extreme pressure. Prologue. He's smart and good-looking, with a satisfying, desirable job. He has a wonderful girlfriend, is liked and respected at both his place of work and in the wider community, and he drives a DeLorean, his all-time favorite car. Simply, Judson Bell's life is awesome, and he couldn't be happier about it. Why, just a moment ago, a man randomly high-fived him, a man he didn't even know. It happened as Judd returned to his office at Johnson Space Center. As NASA's youngest shuttle pilot, he'd been the face of the recent public relations tour. It had been a rousing success, and garnered NASA a boatload of positive press, especially the 60 Minutes piece. Hence the random high five from an enthusiastic co-worker. So 30-year-old Judd Bell is walking on air. Rhonda Jacoby, his partner, who's just as smart and good-looking, with the same satisfying, desirable job, is right there beside him. Around NASA, they are considered the future of the space program, and Judd can't think of a single reason not to agree. Rhonda glances at her Seiko, turns to Judd. The landing. Of course. There's a monitor in here. She directs him to a nearby door, pushes it open. The television in conference room 2 is already surrounded by a crowd of back-office staff. Judd and Rhonda stand behind them and watch the big Toshiba widescreen. On its screen, a small white dot, followed by an elegant comet tail, rips silently across a faultless blue sky. The small white dot pulses, then splits in two. Judd blinks to check his eyes aren't playing tricks, then focuses on the screen again. Two white dots, no tricks. Christ! The grief hits like a fist, overwhelms him. He doubles over, puts his hands on his knees. A woman within the small crowd says to no one in particular, "Gee, that chase plane is high." "It's too high to be a chase plane." The woman turns to Judd. "What is it, then?" He glances at her security pass. She's a PR flack, young, new. He doesn't answer, just looks at Rhonda beside him. Her elegant face is stricken. She knows. "So what is it?" The young flack's voice betrays no sense of alarm, no hint that she may not want to hear the answer. "Debris." Judd says it the only way he knows how to deliver bad news, simple and direct. "Debris?" She still doesn't understand. "It's breaking up." He can't believe he's saying the words. "You're not serious." The flak turns back to the screen. One of the white dots pulses again, and then there are three. The crowd cries out in anguish. Judd runs a hand through his cropped hair, his life no longer awesome. Rhonda turns to him, her eyes wet with tears. "They knew the risk." She's right. After years of training, they all knew the risk, but only in the abstract. No matter what they'd been told or how often, nothing could prepare them for this. For today, the 1st of February, 2003. The space shuttle Columbia is lost, and Judd Bell's best friend is dead, 60 kilometers above Texas, 16 minutes from home. 1. Gerhard Kroll draws the long-handled wire cutters from his backpack and slices into the tall chain-link fence. As he works, he takes in the boneyard. He'd surveilled the place for months, but still found it spectacular. Row after row after row of U.S. military aircraft, over 4,000 of them, all resting in the dry desert air of Tucson, Arizona. The perfect place to dump a big lump of metal if you didn't want it to rust. The Boneyard, or Aerospace Maintenance and Regeneration Center, AMARC, had been the storage location for military aircraft that were surplus to requirements since the end of World War II. Some were stripped for parts, others sliced up and sold for scrap, but most became home to rattlers and scorpions. Gerhard carves a large slit in the chain link, then pulls out his iPhone. He taps the screen, sends a one-word text, then looks south down Kolb Road. The full moon illuminates a Mack truck that rumbles towards him. Headlights off, it tows a long cylindrical tanker. Gerhard points at the hole in the fence, and the Mack's air brakes hiss. It turns off the road, crunches over a small creosote bush, and nudges its radiator against the opening. Gerhard climbs on the driver's step and peers into the cabin. The towering Cobbin Wiseman is behind the wheel. Beside him sits the man in charge, 56-year-old Frenchman Henri Leon. Gerhard nods to him.
No problems.
Henri signals Cobbin, who nudges the Mack through the hole in the fence, the jagged wire scraping the length of the tanker's matte black paint. Gerhard follows it through, then leaps back onto the driver's step and grabs the side-view mirror for balance. Cobbin hits the gas, and the Mack kicks up a rooster tail of dust as it accelerates. Henri takes in Cobbin. Always reliable, he drives the way he does everything, with a single-minded purpose. He's not subtle, but gets the job done. Henri's eyes move to Gerhard. The jury's still out on the young Austrian. A new addition to the Frenchman's crew, he's willing enough, has performed well in the simulations, but you could never tell a man's character until you observed him under pressure. Gerhard's future with the crew will be decided tonight. Henri's eyes flick to the horizon, and he sees it, allows himself a faint smile, the one his wife called the Mona Lisa smile. In an increasingly XS world, the giant C5 galaxy is unashamedly XXXL. When released in 1968, it was the biggest aircraft in the world. Still one of the largest today, it has been in service for over four decades, the backbone of the U.S. military. Henri was 12 and playing on a beach in Guam when he first saw one. As he splashed around in the warm, clear water early one morning, a galaxy soared overhead, turning the sea black with shadow. 3 minutes later, there was another, then another, like clockwork all morning. In the afternoon, they were back, approaching from the opposite direction, shaking the beach, searing his ears with their exquisite sound. It would be many years before he realized those jets had been ferrying men and supplies from Guam's Anderson Air Force Base to the misguided folly in Vietnam. He wonders if he saw this particular plane as a boy. Henri knows it is one of the first built, delivered to the Air Force in September 1970, the last of the A models to be retired. It landed at the adjacent Davis-Monthan Air Force Base earlier that afternoon, was towed to AMARC, and left at this spot. Tomorrow, Air Force personnel plan to dismantle and inspect it to determine the life expectancy of the remaining fleet. The Mack pulls up beside the galaxy's fuselage and is swallowed by the left wing's shadow. To the right is a small hangar. No lights on, nobody at home. Protecting thousands of acres of decommissioned aircraft, many in pieces, none airworthy, was not a U.S. military priority. During the day, there were dozens of employees at AMARC, but at night, only three soldiers guarded the sprawling complex without aid of video surveillance. Even so, Henri knows there'll be plenty of security soon enough. The Frenchman checks his vintage Rolex GMT Master, a 40th birthday present from his wife, then turns to Cobbin and Gerhard.
10 minutes.
They nod, no need for words. They have painstakingly rehearsed exactly what will happen next. They each slip on their two-way radio headsets, then climb out of the Mac. At the front of the tanker, Cobbin unspools a long, thick hose that's attached to a Massport pump. The nozzle at the other end is large and unwieldy, specifically machined for one job. Gerhard heaves it to his shoulder and lugs it towards an area low on the Galaxy's fuselage above the landing gear. He tugs open the fuel cover, slides the nozzle onto the vent, and can't get it on. Cobbin watches him struggle with it, then finally lock it down. Cobbin flicks a switch, and the pump whirs to life. Type A aviation fuel sloshes up the pipe into the Galaxy's tanks. The tanker holds 34,000 liters of avgas and will take no more than 8 minutes to empty it into the Galaxy. It isn't much compared to the 195,000 liters the jet carries when fully fueled, but it'll be enough for tonight. Henri scales a ladder to the Galaxy's forward entry hatch, swings the door open, and extends the built-in ladder to the ground. It's heavy, but he has no trouble with the weight. He draws a P7 Lenser flashlight from the pocket of his flight jacket, illuminates the empty 37-meter cargo bay, exactly 30 centimeters longer than the Wright brothers' first flight at Kitty Hawk in 1903. Then climbs the internal ladder to the flight deck and slides into the co-pilot seat. He takes in the aircraft's controls. Nothing digital here, just a sea of analog switches, buttons, and gauges. A nightmare of options if you didn't know what you were doing. Henri knows, feels right at home, yet he has never sat in a Galaxy before. Bill Gates was rich beyond the dreams of avarice, because his company had created, amongst other things, the flight simulator software that taught Henri how to fly this beast. He flicks switches, turns dials, runs through a pre-flight checklist he knows by heart. The flight deck lights up, gauges spring to life, a muted glow from above illuminates his thinning pate. He glances at his GMT master, then speaks into his headset's microphone.
How long?
Cobbin's voice crackles in his ear.
3 minutes.
Behind Henri, in the walkway that connects the flight deck to the troop bay, a figure appears, silhouetted against the darkness. Henri swivels, a Glock pistol in hand, figure tense on the trigger, then lowers the weapon when he sees who it is.
You're late.
But I'm here. Kelvin Atwater slides into the pilot seat, and they continue the pre-flight checklist in silence. Though outwardly impassive, Kelvin is in fact a bundle of nerves and regret. This is not how he expected his life to pan out. But then who expected to be diagnosed with inoperable prostate cancer and told they had 6 months to live? Kelvin loved being a member of the Air Force. Loved flying this elephantine jet. But after the diagnosis, he realized how little he had to show for his life of service. He'd flown for his country for over 30 years, had done everything asked of him, indirectly, by 5 presidents. And yet, he had only $4,163 to his name, and a little house in central Louisiana that, thanks to Katrina and then the GFC, was worth peanuts. So that's why he agreed to help the Frenchman and take the $1 million on offer. He wanted to retire in style, hopefully die somewhere in the Pacific. An island resort would be nice, a piña colada in one hand and tanned native girl in the other, staring at a glistening ocean as the sun begged his life away.
We're in, Cobbin's voice buzzes in Henri's ear. Fueling complete.
Copy that.
Henri turns to Kelvin.
Ready?
As I'll ever be. We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.